Hello and welcome. This video is for Kristin Burton from Jainism, Hinduism and Buddhism. For example, we have Mount Meru. Santos, Bonacci makes this an actual mountain at the North Pole, which is ridiculous. So this Mount Meru would be the center of the physical, metaphysical and spiritual universes. But Santos Bonacci has got it all wrong. Notice the lotus here atop that mountain in this depiction of Mount Meru. Now we'll go to Darling Park in Sydney and you have the lotus there. Notice the lotus and you have the earth and you have the pillar going through the center, Mount Meru. The worldly lotus, the worldly lotus.
Lotus.
I came across this image titled The Worldly Lotus, and indeed this image fits in with so many other images that I've shown, from the Eiffel Tower to various ritual images. Now in 2003, Jean Douglas penned an article titled Giza's Pyramids and India's Mount Meru, and within there he notes that, and I haven't found any other sources for this, but anyway, according to his writing, the Egyptian word for pyramid is Imru, close to Mount Meru, which is highly interesting. Now within that article he also states that Flavius Josephus made the comparison between Mount Meru and the Garden of Eden. And of course the Garden of Eden would have the tree in it. So from my point of view, this all makes complete sense, strangely enough. Now in this video I'm going to appear to be quite matter or factly about various things. Don't quote me, I'm not telling you what's what. I put up so many images and so much other stuff. Make up your own mind. Don't quote me. Hello and welcome. This video is for Kristin Burton. That's the YouTube name on my channel. I don't know whether male or female. I'm presuming female. Now, Kristin was commenting about the flat earth, and also the conversation seemed to be about Santos Bonacci also, so I'm presuming that Santos has had something to do with this interest in the flat earth. So for those who don't want to hear about the flat earth, I'm going to talk about that, but I'm also going to talk about where I think the whole flat earth thing is completely screwed up and what it really is about. And what we're going to do in this video is we're going to look at some footage I took with Santos Bonacci in 2012. Now, how does this tie in with Kristin Burton? Kristin Burton talked about a fountain with a lotus in the center here in Sydney. And at first I couldn't think what this fountain with a lotus and the flat earth model. And I was thinking, what's happening here? So anyway, I worked it out. It's Darling Park in Sydney, which is a highly occult place. There are all sorts there. I've had the security guards kick me out of there with my camera and all the rest of it. That's another story.
Here we have the complex with the two towers, or perhaps three. This one here I suggest is perhaps an owl relating to the bird symbolism. In the middle here you can see what is perhaps the Stargate, the Visca Pisces symbolism, the lotus symbolism. Here we have the compass and the Stargate symbolism in the middle here.
So within there you have this garden, and you have the flat earth there in the water, the model, and you have the geometries coming out like a lotus. And you have the obelisk type structure in the center with a ball atop and then a crane atop that. We'll see the footage. I talked about this with Santos Bonacci, so it all ties in, Kristin Burton. It all ties in. So I talked about this with Santos in Melbourne in 2012, and we will go to the footage of that soon. So another thing that I talked about with Santos, I talked about the burning bush, and I asked him about that.
Why would they have the bush in the middle of the Visca Pisces, or the vagina or whatever, the Visca Pisces? The Presbyterian Church here in Australia have that as well.
Yeah,
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah.
This was in 2012 before I had my moments myself where things just came to me. And it was in 2012, I met Santos twice in 2012 in person. The second time I actually flew down to meet him, and I'm just honest about it, I was a bit freaked out at the time. I'd twigged onto things, and I've twigged onto things that Santos doesn't get, really. He doesn't get it. He doesn't show it in his work. He doesn't get it. That's fine. He's doing other stuff, and Santos has all this brilliance with his languages and knowledge of the Bible and knowledge of philosophers and all sorts of things. The guy's just brilliant, and I kind of love him in some ways, and then in other ways I'm just like, he just lacks it. There's something there. And that's consciousness within all of us. It's like you have certain things, strengths and weaknesses and all the rest of it. And I have to thoroughly disagree with some of the stuff Santos is talking. Santos spent about 30 years with the Jehovah's Witnesses, and there's all this, everyone's a demon and this is a demon and everything, you know. Like, Santos has considered me a demon for most of his life because of I wasn't a Jehovah's Witness at the time. Now I don't believe in the flat earth, so I'm still a demon and all this. Nothing changes with some people. Santos is still taking the Bible, for example, too literally with this. Okay, so let's talk about Santos talks about Mount Meru and this ridiculous thing at the North Pole, he reckons, that you can't see because it's lapis blue, that goes up into the sky, and there's a city atop it, the city of Brahma atop it, and blah, blah, blah. It's pathetic. It's pathetic. And but what he says about that Mount Meru is he talks about it being magnetic.
The Earth is a flat plane like this. The cosmologies teach us that there's a mountain in the center in the North Pole called Magnetic Mountain or Mount Meru. This is a magnetic mountain, and the color of this is blue. It is lapis blue. So it blends in with the sky, and so it's the same color, and so this cannot be seen. So this cannot be seen. So this cannot be seen.
But what he says about that Mount Meru is he talks about it being magnetic. There's your clue. There is your clue. So with Darling Park, you have the Earth there, and you have the obelisk in the center. And when I was talking with Santos, he talked about that obelisk in the center and how it was the tree also. And that is so true.
Actually, I wouldn't mind. What's your take on that chakra or that?
Well, this appears to me, this is a lotus, and it's either four leaf or eight leaf. And if so, this would pertain to the lower chakras and possibly the solar plexus. And this is solar imagery, you see. 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 And yin and yang, the four elements or the four cardinal points, and you see how they're all sort of connected to the tip of this sun. So I would suggest that this is pointing to the lower chakra of the solar plexus.
Just, did you have anything much to say on this with this pointing north? I'm just trying to remember, with that North Star or whatever, or this is coming out of the North Pole. Did you have anything?
And what's on top of this?
It's the ball with the bird on top. You see that ball, the pole with the ball and the bird is common. This is what it is. So it's got the shaft, and then it's got that ball with Cygnus on top, or that crane on top.
Yeah. All right. Yeah, let's make a comment here. Yeah. Well, this would be the world, you see, and the world tree. There's always a shaft that goes through. It's like an axis. Well, this would be the world, you see, and the world tree. There's always a shaft that goes through. It's like an axis. Well, this would be the world, you see, and the world tree. There's always a shaft that goes through. It's like an axis. Well, this would be the world, you see, and the world tree. There's always a shaft that goes through. It's like an axis. And, of course, at the top of this obelisk that's in the water, again, you see the feminine and the masculine, the male penetrating the feminine world. But it's pointing to the north, as you say there, and there's a bird on top of this obelisk. Well, in the northern dome of the northern skies, there is Cygnus. And usually you'll find that the Saturnian cult and these people, they're always pointing to either Orion or Cygnus or Draco up in the northern stars. So this would be pointing to the northern stars, telling you what's there.
I'll just let this go. What I'm going to do, I'll go up to that point of home part. And do you have anything really to say on that, that point of home?
No, not really.
Yeah, no. Fair enough. Yep.
I don't get any inspiration from that.
With the Vesica Pisces shape here, path of winter solstice sun, path of summer solstice sun.
You're right.
Yeah, I'm stressing.
Good on you.
Stressing.
Stretching. Getting stiff,
yeah. Well, this would be the world, you see, and the world tree.
When I was talking with Santos, he talked about that obelisk in the center and how it was the tree also. And that is so true. If we go to the graveyard of St. Stephen's Church in Newtown in Sydney, you can see the obelisk there with the foliage pouring out. And that's the same with your churches, with everything. Now, this stuff, as the Masons say, and as I've been just repeating for years, is interdimensional, as crazy as that sounds. But that's what the Masons are doing. That's esoteric masonry. Let's just talk about that for a moment. Now, these are my thoughts on it, and I'm just going to try and be brief here. But basically, they're bringing in the energies from the moon, from the sun, from the and it seems to be local. It seems to be local to our area. So it's either planets or stars, star systems, constellations, these sorts of things, bringing in these energies, and in some cases, entities also. There are entities that they are drawing in, and these entities shapeshift, whether they're cherubim, whether they're elementals, and sometimes I just don't know where to make the line between these, and this is what alchemy is really all about, and all these things. Now, it's within the body, it's within the mind, the experience, but it's also out of the body also. You have your, for example, I talk about light structures. Just think about it for a moment. The auras, they are light structures around your body, even if you've never seen them before. So that's light structure in itself around your body. Now, you may not have thought about it like this before, and the same would apply to the chakras also. Now, within Miles Johnson's video with Peter Paget, and he is no doubt a Mason, he talked about that structure going into the body, that kind of light body going into the body and out of the body also. He also talked about it going up and through the head also, making a pillar and all the rest of it. I know that hardly anybody in... He's saying these things and hardly anybody really realizes that what he's really saying and what masonry gets up to and all the rest of it. And he puts it out there and nobody really realizes what he's saying. It's symbolized in churches and all the rest of it. And they don't realize the reality behind this and the light structures and all the rest of it. You have that lotus, right? You've got that flat earth and you've got the lotus there at Darling Park. Now, what do you see in India within the lotus? You see the participant in the center. The participant, but you've got to break the physical away and think about the kind of light structure of the participant. And I actually have an image of an obelisk with the kind of light structure within that participant also. But the mind, our mind, our imagination within the ritual situation is also surely able to create images also. But this is the same for these other entities coming in also that are shape-shifting and all the rest of it. And by the way, with the cherubim, for example, that often look like young boys or young people, small, is that they're not intimidating. And that's one of the other things, they're not intimidating looking. And this may be part of what goes on in the scenario where they're kind of not frightening in a way to the human participants who are interacting with them. Now, just with masonry for a moment, you have the participants in the lodge going up through the chakras and all the rest of it. I was speaking to a master mason just a day or two ago, and he seemed to be having some experiences already within the masonry. So he must be going through must be in with a good esoteric crew. So, and I said to him, I said, look, when I look at the third degree tracing board, I see the aura and I see the light coming out of the head and these sorts of things. And I was blown away. I wasn't expecting it from a master mason. Now, just, I'm diverting a second here, but I talked about video games, and the first game that he mentioned was Assassin's Creed. And that's a video game that I've featured on in some of my films and all the rest of it. The other thing he mentioned that was there, in video games, he talked about Dungeons and Dragons, and that there was an offshoot off Dungeons and Dragons that was highly esoteric. And he said that he actually went to the lodge and showed other lodge members, other Freemasons, this esoteric stuff, Freemasonry that was going on in an offshoot of that's a sort of an attachment of Dungeons and Dragons. I said to him, I came across this image and it had what I would suggest the pedestals there. And so these pedestals would be the kind of light structure around possibly in this case. Now, look, I've got pictures of like the three pedestals also, and you can put candles on them and various other things, and possibly the pyramids that I have with the smoke coming out. And by the way, with that smoke coming out, that is going into the lodge. That is a physical thing that is going into the lodge. The physical lodge is part of what is going on as well, with light structures. Everything is etherically magnetized. The swords, the participants, the whole damn lot, the body, the consciousness is raised through the chakras, other entities are brought in. Now, getting back to Santos, with his flat earth model, he talks about Mount Meru, Sumeru, the lapis blue pillar mountain at the North Pole and all the rest of it, which is pathetic as far as I'm concerned, and the sun going around it and you can't see it because of because it's the same color as the sky. It's pathetic. And with the city of Brahma on the top and crazy stuff. That pillar would be the same pillar that is really sort of in the middle of the Parliament buildings in Canberra, and where they show up with the Capitol Hill program with the pillar in the centre there, and the same with the situation in Armenia as well, where they show that. And I was talking about it before, you know, I even realised these places had showed it to government agencies and all the rest of it. So you are the pillar, you are the tree, you would be in that obelisk, you're in the center of the of that lotus at Darling Park, you're in the center, you are that, you know, this Mount Meru, this etheric, magnetic pillar, mountain, tree, burning bush, tree of good, tree of evil, the knowledge of all these sorts of things, that all runs through you, strangely enough. It's a secret of the human body. It's a secret of the further aspect of the human body. It's just like within science, for example, we don't know where, you know, we don't really know where, or there's no explanation for just various things like dreams and all sorts of states. I don't want to go into it. But the your brain is like a piece of meat in a way. Sure, there's a lot of, you know, there are very complicated processes going in there, and it's a very complicated piece of meat, but it's still a piece of meat. So how can it store the memories of smell and sight and the five, you know, main senses and those sorts of things? How can a piece of meat possibly store that? So there's more going on, I would suggest, and connectedness with other people and all these sorts of things, and entities and so forth and so forth. So depending on the state and the consciousness of the human being as they're going up through the chakras and all the rest of it, you're either a tree, you're either a burning bush, you know, a tree turning into a burning bush, or Mount Meru, all these sorts of things. These are expressions, or I don't quite know the word for it, but this is the higher mind. It is not a physical mountain. And the Christians and Santos, who has spent much of his life being a Christian, much of his life calling other people demons, he would have, for most of my life, I've been a demon to Santos. I've been, I'm going to hell, I'm doing all this sort of stuff, and now I'm a demon because I believe the earth is round rather than flat. So yeah, there were a couple of people who sort of posted comments on one of my videos to do with Santos and the flat earth thing prior, and I think they're pretty onto it. The people doing that flat earth stuff have got it confused with, if you look at various ritual situations, these sort of images that I've been showing, like from Wayne Herschel and people like that, you see the kind of bubble entity in a way, or the, you know, with the you see the pillar in the center, which would be that Mount Meru and all the rest of it, and the phoenix or the bird at the top flying out, and it's right there. This stuff boils down to alchemy and chem, and it's out of Egypt, no doubt out of probably places like Atlantis, if it existed, and those sorts of places, Lemuria, that sort of thing, if these places existed. So this is just a tradition. It's part of our society. It's the at the Aboriginal society, as I've pointed out here in Australia, also has this part to it, and I would suspect that other societies also have that too. There is these secretive aspects to societies, and we may not particularly like it. I could say a lot more to this subject and with the symbolism and so forth, but I'd just like to point out that in some cases you have the animals kind of holding up the layer, so to speak, and you also have the participants, human or other participants, holding up these levels, and this theme just goes right through. This aspect is very intriguing. Just another thing is that with this depiction, you can see the pillars going right through, also through these kind of layers, levels, and that would be the buildings and so forth. So very intriguing interdimensional portrayals being shown, I would suggest.
So what we have here is a shaft, if you will, going through the waters. You got anything to say about the symbolism that's, and it's in other places in Canberra, Santos?
Yeah, look, this goes back to India and Egypt and all those cultures where the phallus is always penetrating, you know, the circle. So the shaft and the circle, and this is all sexual, and it's nature, basically, water and fire, electricity and magnetism, basically.
So what we'll do now is go through a few things that debunk the flat earth thing.
Within Kristen's comments, she expressed concern that we're spinning at thousands of miles an hour, and that you can just stare at the moon and the stars and you don't see a blur in the sky of these because we are spinning so fast. The next video is from YouTube user Dazza the cameraman. It's 5:50 long, and then I'll cover some further points after that.
Then we've got this comment by Raven2000KA2. And he says, I think if somebody believes that oceans can stick to a spinning ball, perhaps their stupidity is already beyond repair. Let's take a look at that spinning ball, shall we? It's spinning away in space as it does, spinning at 1,000 miles per hour at the equator, or approximately 1,600 kilometers an hour. We should all be flying off it, right? Hang on a minute, there's a problem here. Now let's take a minute to think about this, shall we? Okay, I know you don't want to wait a minute. Time is precious. So how about we wait 2 minutes instead? No? Okay, well, how about 1,440 minutes? Why 1,440 minutes? Well, that is how many minutes there are in 24 hours. And with this analog clock, we can clearly see, we can easily see the second hand racing around the face of the clock. But can you see the minute hand moving? Now that minute hand goes around this clock 1,440 times in a 24-hour period. But can you see it moving? Well, you can just see it moving, and if I position my cursor here to make it easy, you can probably see it moving very, very slowly. But what about the hour hand? Can you see the hour hand moving? Now, it's impossible to perceive. And remember that with this analog clock, the hour hand actually goes around 12 hours twice in a day. You've got 12 hours AM and you've got 12 hours PM because there are only 12 points on the face of the clock. It's not a 24-hour clock that takes 24 hours for the hour hand to go around once. It actually goes around twice in 24 hours. So here is a bit of a clue as to where we're going with this video, looking at the hour hand on this analog clock and how fast it moves in a 24-hour period. So let's go back to our spinning Earth, spinning around at 1,000 miles per hour or 1,600 kilometers an hour at the equator. But hang on a minute, this is going much too fast, as you can see from the clock up in the corner there. Let's play this real time. So here is the Earth spinning in real time, and if you look at the clock up here, we can see that the time is running at real time, 1 second per second, as it should. I've got the time flow rate set at one time, or real time, and we can't perceive the rotation of the Earth. Now, this view here is set from the center of the Sun. We're looking straight at the Earth in real time, and we cannot perceive any rotation. Yes, it is true that the Earth is spinning at 1,000 miles per hour, or approximately 1,600 kilometers per hour at the equator, but obviously it's not spinning like a spinning top. Let's speed this up by 60 times and see how that looks. Now, that is 1 minute per second. You can barely perceive that the Earth is turning. If you look very carefully, you can see that it's turning, and that's at 60 times normal speed. Let's increase that to 600 times. Okay, so now we can see that the Earth is spinning, and that is at 600 times normal speed, but it's hardly spinning like a spinning top, is it? Do you really think that at real time that the oceans should be flying off the Earth and that people should be flying off the Earth if it's a globe Earth, given that it takes 24 hours to make one rotation of the Earth? Remember, we looked at that hour hand on the clock, and that rotates around the face of the clock twice in a 24-hour period. But the Earth rotates once in a 24-hour period. Can you see it turning? I can't. So why should we expect that the oceans would simply fly off the Earth and that all the people would be flung off the Earth because of the spinning force of the Earth at 1,000 miles per hour at the equator? Yes, that's fast, but the Earth in itself is not spinning like a top. Think about it, flatties. When you go outside, when you can drag yourself away from the computer and go outside and look at the night sky, and you see the stars, do you see the stars racing across the sky? Do you see the moon racing across the sky? How long does it take for the sun or the moon or the stars to cross from one horizon to the other? Yes, it takes about 12 hours, doesn't it? If we speed this up like I did before, at say 60 times, which is 1 minute per second, you can just see the stars are moving. If I speed that up to 600 times, which is 10 minutes per second, you can clearly see the stars going across the sky. But in real time, we can barely see the stars moving across the sky. And it is the same with the Earth, looking at the Earth from space, which is why the water doesn't go flying off and why the Earth is not spinning fast like a spinning top as you would have us believe.
Okay, Kristin, this is a concept drawing of the flat Earth model. And this line around here would represent the pathway of the Sun around December the 22nd. This line here would represent the pathway of the Sun around the date of June the 22nd. So I live in Sydney. Now, this is December the 22nd here. Now, around December, the Sun would typically set at about 8 o'clock at night, and it would be out of sight for 9 hours and 40 minutes around that time. So this line would represent 24 hours. So what I'm going to do out of that 24 is take about 9 hours and 40 minutes out of it. So I'm just going to guess that, and let's say it's about from here to around about there, say. Maybe that's not quite accurate, around about there. But anyway, around about that distance, that would perhaps represent about 9 hours and 40 minutes. So what I'll do, and this is just crude, but anyway, so my vision, my eyes in Sydney on that day can see the sun from here to a distance of here. Now, if I was to live in New York, which is here, I should be able to see the sun all the time, because if we draw a line now from New York across to about here, that would be the longest distance the sun would ever be away from New York. So as you can see, this line here is shorter than this line here. So as far as the flat earth model goes and this concept goes, because I can see the sun in Sydney from here to here, this means that from New York, with that shorter distance, I should be able to see the sun every day, 24 hours a day, all year round. I hope you get the grasp of this. There are many other points I could make, but I'm actually going to leave it at this because this subject is lunacy. And as far as flights go, I have friends and family who travel direct from, say, Sydney, Australia, to Johannesburg in South Africa, and also from New Zealand direct to South America also. So it's just bullshit, some of the lies that people say. And Santos is either a liar in this respect or has brought into it. Without getting into whether the United Nations is an organization of good or evil, the logo features all of the significantly inhabited nations of the planet. I would expect this. From a NASA website, we can see that they pretty much state that the sky appears blue. They are also the organization that would tell us that the Earth is basically a sphere. So they tell us that the sky is blue and that the Earth is a sphere. Are both these things incorrect? Yes, NASA may lie about various things, this and that, for sure. But is everything that NASA says a lie? I'll leave it at that.